My name is Michael McFall. I'm the director of the Freeman Spogli Institute. Welcome to our Friday afternoon seminars. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, we did this on a weekly basis over the summer, and then we decided everybody was exhausted with Zoom, and we're going to let our centers drive the programming. But every now and then, there's special occasions that we need to celebrate. For those of you who have never written a book, I've written a few of them, and they're really, really hard things to do. It takes a lot of energy and time and persistence to do them. And so they should be celebrated when they are written. And I'm delighted that today we are celebrating the publication of Invisible China, How the Urban-Rural Divide Threatens China's Rise. Here it is. I will make sure to circulate the link so you can get it. Scott, are you giving any discounts today?
I think they get a discount if they go to the University of Chicago Press.
Okay. I'll send around that link.
Got it. Thanks, Mike.
By our own colleague here, Scott Rozelle with Natalie Hell. Scott has been, he just told me to introduce him. He's been researching and writing about China for 500 years. I think that's what he wanted me to say. But seriously, nobody knows China, especially rural China, better than Scott. We're delighted to have him at FSI, and we're delighted that he's agreed to do this book talk with us today. I'm going to turn it over to Hongbin Li, who is a new senior fellow with us at FSI. He's also over at CEPR, which is the photo behind him right now, and has collaborated with Scott on many projects over many years. Hongbin will host our event today. Thank you all for being here. And Scott, seriously, congratulations on getting this book. It's a fantastic achievement.
Thanks, Mike.
Over to you, Hongbin.
Yeah, thank you, Mike. First of all, I would like to congratulate Scott for publishing such an important book. I'm also very proud because Scott is my own PhD advisor. Literally, we met about 30 years ago in China. When I was a poor student, I was wondering what I'm going to do after college. So I met this young guy, Scott was really young, I think in his 30s, was an assistant professor from Stanford. He was having dinner with a group of students, including his student from Stanford. He was like making fun of his student, and his student also joke about him. So I was puzzled, how can a student tell a joke about a professor, I mean, in front of other people? So he didn't look like a scholar or professor to me, actually. So anyway, luckily he brought me to Stanford. So here I am. So today he is the agenda for the rest of the event. Scott first will present a few key findings of the book. I will then have a talk with Scott, conversation. After that, we'll open up for questions. By the way, you can ask a question anytime from now on by using the Q&A function in Zoom at the bottom of the screen. So Scott, your floor.
Thank you, Hongbin, and Mike, and the whole FSI staff, and thanks to Natalie. Natalie is a co-author. She worked at FSI for years, and if you read the book, you'll see it reads really, really well. Natalie's the writer. She's a phenomenal writer, as well as having intellectual input into the book, for sure. So I just want to start off, now we're around this election time. This is not a China bashing book, okay? We want to get rural China's human capital improving as fast as possible for three reasons. Humanistic, you'll see a few of the people I've interacted with over the last 500 years, last 40 years. And, you know, they are hardworking, good the people. They're the backbone of China's economy. And I don't want to see them hurt in the future. Economic, if China's economy stagnates or falls, it's not going to be good for China, and it's not going to be good for the U.S. It's not going to be good for the world. And overall, Asia, I'm a development economist that squats in the village and does surveys. I don't know much about political science or military science or anything, but you could see a legitimacy problem occurring if China's growth stagnates or falls, and it wouldn't be good for Asia, it wouldn't be good for the world. So it may not be the most PC thing to say, but for many, many reasons, I want China to succeed. Of course, I want that to happen in a fair, cooperative, all-encompassing way. So that's sort of the background of the book here. So what's the invisible China? Invisible China is rural China. Flat out and simple, right? And you know, China just passed 1.4 billion people mark. 60% of them are rural, and that makes somebody told me it's actually 1/9 of the world's population. So 1/9, 1 out of 9 people are in this invisible place in China, and you know, they're the ones behind factory walls. They're out on the streets. Recycling material, selling at food stands, bringing your Starbucks coffee to your office when you're in Beijing or Shanghai. They run the farms. And of course, they're also the elderly that are left in the villages with the children that are left in the villages, or they're the migrant community, the families that are in migrant communities stuck in the dark alleys in the cities. When I first started working in China, it was actually 37 years ago, more than 85% of Chinese lived in rural communities. Even a higher percentage had families, their grandparents, their parents, their brothers and sisters that were in farming or working in factories, rural factories. Professionals, college students, government, they were all rural, tied to rural areas. They went back and forth, right? When you had to go across the country, you got on a bus, right? I mean, China had horrible infrastructure at that time. And the bus would stop at night at a village inn, and you'd eat at a farmhouse restaurant. You know, here's rural China. I had just received my offer to Stanford. When these photos were picked, I was finishing my follow-up round of my survey. And you know, you can see that, I mean, this is a place where, you know, lots and lots of people hung out. It wasn't invisible 30 to 40 years ago. Okay. But that's different today, right? I mean, 5% of students in elite universities have rural roots, only 5%, 60% of the population, 70% of children, only 5% of kids are in these elite universities. If you don't fly across the country, you take a high-speed rail. I like taking photos, right? And you can't take a photo of a village when the train's going 350 kilometers an hour. It just blurs. And of course, the media, international and China, they cover Shanghai, Beijing, Shenzhen, right? They don't get the invisible China. I mean, it's out there, it's all around, but you just don't see it. And you know, this is for Chinese in the cities as well as us in America and across the world. So, what basis was this book published on? I mean, what you're going to see is since 88, 89, I've executed surveys and done in-depth field work in 28 provinces and municipalities, 650 counties. Our whole REAP staff was trying to count. We think we've done over 1 million surveys. We've gone into 1 million households, schools, factories, hospitals, clinics, and collect primary data. And this sort of helps us try to then relate to the rest of the world what this China looks like, okay? So, but that's not what this book's about, okay? This book is about how, you know, why would an economist even be interested in this, right? Because I want to know how it's going to affect China's development, its economic rise. And this is the only graph I'm going to show, okay? But it's an important graph. Okay, so in this horizontal axis, it's 1960 income, 70 years ago. This is income today. And so the countries down here, this is the Congo and Myanmar, they were poor before and they're poor now. Here are the OECD countries, right? The rich countries, Canada, Norway, right? Australia, okay? And so they were rich before and they're rich now. I'm interested in two sets of countries trying to understand, and these are called the graduates. And There's only 15 of them. In the last 60 years, there's only been 15 countries that have risen from middle class to high income, right? That's what China's trying to do, right? People think China's already done with that, but we'll come back to that. But you can see it's the Singapore, it's South Korea, Ireland, Israel, right? Taiwan territory or the Republic of Taiwan, right? It's these countries that have were middle income and now they're high income, okay? The other is the trapped, right? Look at this. Most countries in the world are trapped, right? In other words, that 60 years ago, they were middle income and today they're middle income. And it's not they're in nice little equilibrium. They go crash. And there's lots of pain and suffering as this happens, okay? So what I'm interested in is, you know, what differs from here to here? What differentiates that? And one fundamental difference is at the time of middle income, in those graduates, their labor force, this is everyone from 18 to 65, they have to be well educated, because when you move up to this next level, you have to be able to participate in this new high income, high skill economy, okay? So let's see, compare that. So here are the rich countries, right? So this is the United States. We're like 78 out of 100. OECD, all the rich countries are 74 out of 100. 7 or 8 out of 10 workers have been to high school or higher, okay? And look at those middle income grads, when they were middle income. So South Korea, the wage was $1 an hour and the entire labor force, or 7 out of 10 of the labor, had been to high school, okay? And so that they already had developed country levels of education when they were middle income, okay? Now, let's go look at the trapped. Wow, right? It's half of that, right? They're 3 out of 5 out of 10, 4 out of 10. That means in this labor force, you have 60 or 70% of your labor force are high school dropouts, or they've never been to high school. And how can you, you know, and so you see the difference. It's important because as you move from middle income to higher income, wages rise. The nature of work changes from low skill, low wage, to high wage, high skill. And if you're not educated, you're not going to be part of this. I mean, a small share will be, but not if 70% of your labor force is like this. And you start to get a polarization, unemployment, high crime, social unrest, the rise of informalness. We're going to be looking at this a little bit closer. And of course, once you get high crime, social unrest, nobody wants to invest. You get this stagnation and this vicious circle down. Okay. So, let's just look at the rest of the world when a large share of your labor force goes into this informal economy. And there's a lot of countries there, the Mexico and India, Indonesia, Argentina, Brazil. Look at 40 to 50% to 60% of the people in these countries, laborers in the labor force, not kids or elderly, but in the labor force. They work in this informal economy, right? No benefits, no set wage. They aren't covered. There's no hours. They're sort of separated from society, right? And you know what it looks like, right? This is taken in Mexico City almost exactly a year ago when our group went down there for a conference. And then they crowd up into the areas around the city, right? Santiago Levy, he used to be a professor at Harvard. He's now at the Inter-American Development Bank, works on Latin America. He calls this the Mexican paradox. You know, as I'm saying this, think China, right? He says Mexico has solid macroeconomic performance. It has export success. It has accumulated lots and lots of physical capital. All right. Gosh, does that sound familiar? It sounds just like China right today. Mexico, however, has had very low growth since the late 1980s, early 1990s. Why? Because Levy says, because productivity has stagnated, this informal sector is too large. It drags the economy. It absorbs resources, and it slows these economies down, so they stagnate. Okay, and there's Mexico, right? You can see why, you know, these a large, over two thirds of the Mexican economy can't read and write at a high school level. They don't know how to learn how to learn. So, okay, so I'm going to get into China now. This is about China, right? There's so many people, when I give this talk, you know, I send out this op-ed to a couple of big newspapers, and the editor comes back and says, come on, you're gonna say, you know, that the rural economy is going to undermine China's growth. China's made it already, hasn't it? I want to remember everybody about the 1980s. Most of you probably aren't that old, but I was in grad school then. We were studying Mexico as an example of a fast-growing country that had made it. They were that Mexico is a part of OECD. They had already determined that Mexico was the high-income economy, right? It was called the next Taiwan. I love that, right? and so you know that, hey, where you are when you're an upper middle income doesn't necessarily mean that's where you're going to be. That trajectory. So where's China in this human capital world of nations? Okay, there they are. They're middle income, right? They're upper middle income now, right? They've made a lot of progress. And you remember, kids don't all need to go to college, but if you want to participate in a high income, high tech, high skill economy, you better have the math, science, language skills, computer skills that allow you to learn how to learn, because things are going to change very fast, right? And it's at this critical stage of development that children get all the skills they need. Where is China? Okay, in this. When I give this in China, people gasp. I don't care if you're at Tsinghua University or if you're at the American Chamber of Commerce. They've never heard this. I tell people, China has the lowest level of human capital in the middle income world. Lowest, number one. We're their number one low. And they go, China, right? And then they said, well, where do you get your data, Scott? They think it's my data, right? This is data from this little census survey of 1.4 billion people, when people told us what their education levels were. Okay. And what you can see is, of this whole labor force, only 30%, three out of 10, seven out of 10, and this is urban and rural, so this is the entire labor force has been there. And so you can see, when we compare this to the rest of the world, right, China has lower human capital than South Africa, lower human capital than Turkey, okay, and in this very critical metric. You know, when we say here in America, you're a high school dropout, right? I mean, that's not good, right? Because a high school dropout in a high income country, the probability of being in jail, in disability, on welfare, on unemployment, is 4 to 5 times higher than having a stable middle income life. So you don't want to be a high school dropout and when you're in a high income, high skilled economy. You know, exactly where China is trying to go to, of course. Okay. Now, this is brand new data. It's also government data. I just want to show you that even the government statistics show that China is moving quickly in the same direction that Mexico moved and some of these other countries moved. So look at here, 2004, you can see on the side of the graph, almost 70% of the labor force who had a job was working in the formal employment. So they had a job, they had benefits, they were part of this structure. And look at over the last 15 years, okay? It's now less than 45%, okay? Nearly 60% of, look at this informal here, getting bigger and bigger, nearly 60% of Chinese workers now are in the informal economy. They don't have benefits, okay? They don't have a set job. They're in and out. They're sort of disconnected with you know, the formal economy, the same thing that undermined Mexico and so many of these other things. And this is, look at this data. Where are these people coming? Why is it growing so fast? Well, manufacturing's going down now. Construction's going down. No one's going into farming. Yes, there's growth in skill-intensive services. So these are the professionals, right? The Silicon Valley people, right? And the doctors and the professors. But who's growing much, much faster are the people that are going into the informal economy, because there's no place else for them to go. As manufacturing falls, as construction falls, new entrants and these laid off workers get dumped into the service sector. And let me quickly go through here and look what's happening. Their wages are falling. Okay, professional wages are going up. Wow, this sounds like, right? Silicon Valley wages are going up. And the low income working class in America, they're going down. This is sort of the start of what we see in many high income countries like us, the start of this polarization that's happening. And what's driving these trends, okay? And it's really good. Hongbin Lee has written probably more than any other economist about robots in China. And this is what's replacing labor out there and throwing people out of jobs. Globalization, right? Levi's are now made in Ethiopia, and Chinese firms move to Bangladesh to take advantage of much, much cheaper labor. And Samsung assembles everything in Vietnam, right? And then, of course, we got the recession, which is an extra push as it's decline, you know, pulling the rug out from under the employment figures, okay? And should we expect more, right? Here are robots around the world, and there's China, here's North America, here's Germany, right? Look at this, right? China, made in 2025 isn't talked about anymore, but it's certainly part of the plan. And if you followed the plenum that just happened, it's technology, 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 including we want to automate our factories and become the robot capital of the world. Supply chains are going to continue to shift, okay? So should we expect more of this rise of the informal economy, fall of manufacturing, fall of construction? Maybe, probably. Yeah, I would think probably so. So what does it mean for the invisible China, right? I think that what we're saying is, you know, if China does manage to become a high income country, what are the 500 million high school dropouts? What does a country do with 500 million high school dropouts? Okay. Remember, they're not high school dropouts. They haven't ever been to a day of high school. Okay. And I'm just going to ask one thing. I'm not going to spend any time on it. Wrap up my comments. Does anybody know this about this in China? I've had that question asked so many times. This isn't a secret. Okay. I don't think. I think there's some invisibility to the sources of that problem, but just real quick, these aren't the whole labor force. This is just 15 and 16 year olds. So these are high school age children. So look at as late as 2005, only half of kids were going to high school, right? In 1990, it was 25%, right? So, but look at over the last 10 years, right? China has added 10 million new slots to high school. So they're saying, oh my gosh, if we want these kids to be part of the economy, we need them to go to high school. So they recognize that too, right? And they want to universalize high school by this year. COVID-19's put it back. And the only thing to see is when you divide those numbers by rural and urban, this is a rural problem, okay? Here's today, only half of the kids in 15 to 17 year olds in poor rural areas are going to high school, okay? Everybody in urban areas are going. Look at in Taiwan and South Korea in 1970s, everyone was in high school. Everybody was in high school, right? Rural, urban, okay? Look at Mexico in the 1980s. Oh, who does China look like? I know. So this is the conclusion. The challenge of the government today is twofold. We need to get everyone into high school. We need to try to get our adults retrained. Uh-oh. Adult retraining is really, really hard, especially if you don't have the skills to learn how to learn. Second is, are the kids going to be ready to learn when they get to high school? This is the invisible problem. So China's going to get everybody into high school, but there's a large share. So the number two is precisely the problem. There's a large share of rural people that don't have the skills to learn how to learn, will not be able to take advantage of the new opportunities. You put them in high school, they're not going to be able to learn those skills because they aren't ready to learn. And what's wrong? The wrong is that children, youth, young adults, working age, rural individuals, you know, aren't going to high school. They'll only be able to join this informal low wage workforce. Okay. And chapters 5, 6, 7, 8 of the book, we talk about the problems and you know, these are our data. There's unsatisfied teachers, no software in the schools, not enough money. There's huge early childhood development problems. These are the invisible challenges. So I'm going to leave it there. Again, I hope China succeeds. I think it's going to be really, really hard. If you say, will China look more like the Philippines in 2030s or Japan? I think it's 50-50. So I'm going to stop there, Hongbin. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Scott. I have known Scott for 30 years. I know Scott's work is really influential, both here and in China. One day when I talked to my dad, who lives in Jilin, an inland province in China, he was so excited. He said, oh, I saw a news article about Rozelle. Rozelle is Scott's Chinese name, actually. So my dad doesn't know how to use a computer. He doesn't have a smartphone. He only reads local newspaper. The local newspaper in a small town in China reports Scott's story. Actually, some of the stories of Scott in this book go viral in China's social media, such as WeChat, Weibo, because he has made the invisible China visible to Chinese. That's right, actually. Most Chinese also don't know that much about rural China. I read a lot of the comments following this WeChat, Weibo stories. So Chinese readers are really amazed, also very curious about Scott. Why is this American professor from Stanford, who speaks perfect Chinese, spending 40 years in China, traveling from village to village to talk to farmers, school teachers, and children? So here's my question, Scott. As an economist, you started to study China 40 years ago, when China's economy was really tiny. So what can you tell to the younger generations of our students at Stanford or in other places of the US who are interested in China? Can you share a little bit of your own story?
There's many ways I could take this question, Hongbin. The whole background was I started learning Chinese as a 11-year-old in Southern California. That the Department of Defense China had just split with the Soviets, and the Department of Defense was putting Chinese into junior high and high schools around the country, and they chose our school randomly. I mean, there was no reason to put it there. My dad, who had been in Shanghai after the war, said, take it. And I said, okay. Then I went to Taiwan in the mid 70s, and I got sort of mentored by a professor at University of Taiwan who took me around and would take me to the field and show me, this used to be really, really poor, and look at it in Taiwan today. This used to be, you know, a dirt road, and now it's a freeway. And, you know, Taiwan's developing on the back of, you know, investments in infrastructure, but also into human capital, health, and education. I got really interested in development economics. And that's why I ended up, going to Cornell and studying economics and doing what I really wanted to. I think the lesson I would tell people is, you know, go out and see things, right? If you read about them, right, you know, go to the field, talk to people. As a social scientist, right, I mean, you know, Hongbin, it's, I know half of your papers, they, you know, it's you walking the streets in a central Chinese city and people saying, you know, I wish I lived across the river where they didn't have all that smoke, you know, coming out of the of their smoke sacks every morning. They're all healthy. And I, you know, I have emphysema. And, you know, it's me going to the field with, it was actually three Stanford undergrads, one of them who just got a job at Harvard this year, right, got a PhD from Stanford. And, you know, we had a list of questions of what rural people wanted. It was done by the Ministry of Agriculture, more irrigation, more roads, more drinking water. And at the bottom question said other. And we gave this to 20,000 farmers, 20,000 households. And do you know what 10,000 of them did? They picked up their pen and they said, we want everything above, but we want education more than anything. Because if we aren't educated, we aren't going to have a future. That's when REAP started, that day. So it's taking your students to the field, taking your colleagues to the field, and talking to people and finding out the real situation. And it doesn't matter what you study. It's when you're studying people, it's just fantastic.
Yeah, thanks. There are a lot of questions coming up. Let me ask another question, then I'm going to ask the question from the audience, actually. So my second question is that there's a lot of misunderstanding, misconception about China. Not only here, but also in China. Today, so the image of China would be a superpower competing with the US in areas such as high tech, education and research, military, geopolitics, to name a few. Your book has painted a completely different picture. And it's about the majority of the Chinese population, 800 million people. And it's about the future of China. So why is there such a contrast of these two different images of China?
I mean, I really think it probably comes back to, you know, the real issues is actually, we could write 5 books, Hongbin. We could write 10 books. It's called Invisible China. We could write a series of books called Invisible China, colon. I wrote it, colon, How the Rural-Urban Divide Will Undermine China. You know, I think that, and it, they're not all, also undermine growth, but or this will behind the growth, is one of the big problems is we don't even understand what's going on in China today. I mean, there's so little real research, real data coming out of China today. So I like to use this as an example. Okay, in 1980s, at the height of the Cold War, okay, U.S.-Soviet, you know, competition, the top 50 economics departments in the country, all right, had 65 economists, all funded by the federal government, working on Soviet-U.S. relations, economic relations, and Eastern Europe, and et cetera, et cetera. 65. Today, those top 50 universities, you know, I'm in FSI. Thank you, FSI. I mean, I love being at Stanford. You're in CEPR. Yeah, the top 50 economics departments, there's two. And guess what? They're not funded by the federal government. The federal government won't even fund China studies, right? And so we have got this empirical information vacuum, right? And I think that, you know, luckily here at Stanford, you know, you've been able to, you know, penetrate into the factories and find out what's happening with worker management rights. You know, I've been doing the rural area. We have, you know, some economists work in the environment. You know, trying to understand, there's a carbon trading plan. Is that working? Well, you know, Larry Goulder is working on it, right? But he does it part-time, right? Because there's not, you know, a full-time person working on that. How about, does China really have more solar power in the rest of the world? Guess what? No one's ever studied it, right? I could keep going on and on. I think the bottom line is, you know, we need to drastically improve our understanding of China, and then we need to communicate it to Washington, to the business community in China, in the U.S.
All right. I'm going to pick up questions. There are like so many questions from the audience. So first, there are a few clarification questions. So Scott, this is a quick question. So what do you mean rural China? Do you mean Hukou, the people of its rural Hukou, or the people living in rural China?
Yeah. Yes. So so this is what I always say, right, is on the day they do the census, which is, you know, June 1st, 2020, it was a hard one this year because of COVID-19, but June 1st, 2010, that 60% or 60% of China was in a city, okay? And so China will say our urbanization rate is now up to 60%, okay? But China also has a policy called a Hukou policy, and you're either urban resident or, I always like to kid, you know, in China, everybody has tattooed rural or urban here. It's actually not true. They're not tattooed there. They have an identity card, and it's just like having a tattoo, because that will guarantee you where you get schooling, where you get healthcare, where, if you get social security, if you get unemployment insurance, and it's less than 60%, I mean, more than 60% of people in China have a rural identity card. Okay, and so that's the clarification. And 60% of them, it's actually 70% of the kids. 70% of the kids today have a rural identity card, and 63% of them go to school in rural areas.
Okay, so another question is that economy needs all people with different education levels. Do we think Chinese really need to be all educated like by college or high school, people can have different kind of education.
We don't all need to be South Koreas, where, you know, 102% of every cohort in the last 10 years has gone to college, right? It's like older people, adults going back to college, right? That's the extreme, right? But I tried to make the argument there, and I think that not everyone needs to go to in a high tech, high skill economy. A small share needs to be the nannies, the landscapers, you know, the waiters and the cooks in the back, the dishwashers. You need that, right? You don't need 70% of your economy. China doesn't need 500,000. Okay, they don't need 500,000 people in this service sector economy. Okay, and you see what's happening, right? Is the amount of people dumping into this service sector economy is more than the demand for it. So wages are going down, okay? I just think if you sit back and think about it, right? You know, how many times in a high-skill economy do you switch jobs, right? How many times, and if you don't have the ability to learn how to learn, to pick up a manual, to take an online course, to go get adult training, right? If you just have a junior high level of education, where, you know, you got a little math and a little, you don't have integrated thinking skills, you just can't do it. And I think that you saw the numbers, right? There's no country that's graduated there that hasn't had most of their, can China change that? Yeah, we'll see.
So this is another question. You know, Chinese are famous for caring about education. We have all heard the book called Tiger Mom of Chinese, right? By Amy. We have met Amy. So this seems to be different from what we think, how Chinese care about education. do rural parents care about their children's education? Or they care, but they cannot afford, or they cannot do it, for their kids.
Right. Yeah. If you read the book, you'll see this is one of the invisible problems. Okay. And it's not the supply side. Okay. In other words, I'm sorry. I've got to get my supply and demand curves right. It's not the demand side. We, for a number of reasons, we can go into them later. We started working in high school and then went to junior high and then went to elementary school. Now about half of our work with early childhood development is that we really need, okay, but I'm not gonna go there, but we've done lots of surveys of moms and grandmas with their 6-month-old baby or their toddlers. And we've asked them, almost 20,000 moms and grandmas, we said, what's your educational aspirations for your kid? Okay, so do Chinese really care about education? My second favorite number of anyone we produced lately is 95%. What do you mean 95%? 95% of those moms say, I want my kid to go to college. Okay, when they're that old. Now, when their kid gets to 13 years old, they drop out. All right, but when they have the demand to go to college, my first favorite number is 17%. Do you know what 17% of rural families say they want their kid to do? To get a PhD. I always tell them, no PhD, no. MBA, okay, don't get a PhD, you'll be poor like us, And no, they have the demand. The problem is, it's the school system, right? And China's school system, I don't want to go too deep into this because we could go on and on. China has a decentralized school system. They have a decentralized social service system, everything, health, social security, unemployment, and education. There's 40,000 school districts in China. The United States, by the way, has 40,000 school districts. And and they're all locally funded. And our school districts are locally funded. China's school districts are locally funded. So if you go to Palo Alto, wow, you get fantastic schooling. But, go to Southside Chicago or go to Southern Idaho, right? And you don't get good schooling, right? And because they're underfunded, they don't get good teachers, they don't have. And that's what's happening in China today. And they're very underfunded. The teachers are very poor quality. They're good people. Now, I love teachers in China, but they aren't good quality. They aren't good teachers, and because they're underpaid and they have terrible working conditions, and so it's a supply side problem, and I think that's the invisible problem, right? It's not China, and they have to get it right now, right?
Okay, so here I think a few questions about this. So the invisible China involves a huge part China's population. But in terms of their influence, they have really a small voice, both in China and in the rest of the world, because they cannot get their voice heard by people. So what should they do to get their voice heard? What should the educated people in China do to help them? What should the government in China do? What should Americans do? So these are all related questions. I mean, not one person, there are several questions on this.
No. I think it's, the obvious problem is that Donald Trump and Joe Biden are campaigning today in the farm states, right? Because the farmers have a voice. They have a voice because they have a vote, right? And they don't have that there, okay? And I don't see that changing. And if you go protest in today's China, you don't get very far, okay? So you don't have a protest voice, right? The fact is I see little path for them having a voice until that voice perhaps is going to be like the voice of the poor in Mexico, right? Well, the poor in Mexico actually have a vote, right? But the poor in Mexico have their biggest voice through the violence and the crime. And now, you know, that voice is often met by by crackdown and by oppression, right? In you know, many, many countries, right? But, you know, that's what I keep saying. I go, you know, if you don't think there's going to be a rise of organized crime in China over the next 10, 15 years, I think that you're wrong, right? The government, I think, is already responding. They're recruiting a very large internal police force. I think that they, for many, many reasons, but that's for one of them, okay? And so I just don't see this voice of rural people having any voice. And now what has to happen is I think that urban Chinese have to realize that, you know, we need to speak for them, right? And I think that they have to realize. I always say, you know, I told you already, you know, is China going to look more like the Philippines, or is it going to more like Japan in 10 years, right? Or 15 years, right? And I say, I'm an economist on one hand, on the other hand, 50% probability they're going to look like Philippines. You know, 20% probability they're going to look like the Philippines. Okay. I mean, 80% probability they're going to continue, you know, they're going to continue to grow, or at least, you know, maintain themselves. Okay. So, but it's a 20% probability. What should the government do? They should buy an insurance policy, right? They should buy an insurance policy. And that insurance policy's, you know, it's like us buying an insurance policy. It's not cheap, right? But it reduces the risk. And I think that insurance policy is, you know, massive investment into rural health, massive investment into rural education, early childhood development, massive investment into the unemployment insurance, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a lot of people there, right? So it's going to take a lot of shifting. So they're going to have to make hard decisions, right? You know, I always say, I used to say, don't go to the moon. We know what's at the moon, right? China, and you know, people get really, you know, you guys went to the moon, we should be able to go to the moon. And I like the moon program, right? And okay, what about high-speed rail from Xi'an to Urumqi? You could build a parenting center and fund it for 5 years in every single village in China for the cost of building a high-speed rail from Xi'an out to Urumqi and Xinjiang. Okay? That's what you could do. And I say, and they say, well, don't you want to have Xinjiang connected to China? I want to take an airplane, right? Fly there, no problem. And they're making a high-speed rail from Chongqing to Kunming. Do you know what that means? Here's the Himalayas, here's Chongqing, here's Kunming. You got to go through a mountain. You got to go through the middle of the Himalayas for like 700 miles, right? Do you know how much it's going to cost? So I think it's going to be hard. What can we do in the U.S.? Let's talk about that in another question. Do research on China, educate the U.S. I think that if we can educate U.S. policymakers, U.S. government officials, and in the business community, that China is much more vulnerable. It's not a done deal that they're the superstar superpower of the world.
Yeah, I think the question basically is that how does this affect China's growth perspective in the future? What's the worst scenario? And how does that low education or rural people and also the unemployment issue affect China's stability? What does it mean for the US, actually? I think this is the reframe the question, actually. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, but it's why I'm interested in this. I'm not bashing China, okay? I'm worried about the, you know, we're selfish, right? We want a peaceful, booming economy in the U.S. at least growing steadily, right? And, if China stagnates or China stops growing, it's going to be a big part of U.S. growth is going to fall, okay? And big parts of the growth, they're a part of this economy, okay? So I think a growing China that's fairly integrated into the rest of the world, okay, that fairly operates on the world rules, there's a lot of work to do there, okay? I'm not being apologetic to China. They have a lot to do on this, okay? But if they do it, it's going to help the world grow. So that's why we should care. But mostly, I mean, you know, China gets its legitimacy, right, through growth, right, through the constant upward growth of income for 40 years in a row. If that stops, where do they get their legitimacy, right? And, you know, it could be stoked by nationalism, right? And how do you create nationalism? Well, there's, you know, there's lots of ways. There's lots of places around China's borders where they could stoke nationalism. You know, part of it is the South China Sea. Part of it is their southern neighbors. Part of it is their northern neighbors, right? So I think that there's lots and lots of reasons why we should care. And it's not going to be, you know, and it's going to take lots of hard work for us to do this, right? I often say the number one thing that we need to do is engage China, but we've tried to engage China the last 4 years, you know, I mean, but guess what? We tried to do it on our own, and then we let every other country do it on their own. And, you know, us engaging China on our own caused a lot of this. Now, of course, it's also the way you engage them. But the other thing is the rest of the world, they can't do this with China. I mean, here's China, here's the rest of the world, right? Every individual country where China has a stick here and a bag of carrots here, right? And so we got to get the world together. We got to get the Europeans, the Japanese, the Australians, the Canadians, the U.S. to go into China and, you know, renegotiate a fair package for us participating in China and China participating with us. And it's got to be a fair set of rules for China. You know, if it's too oppressive to China, they aren't going to agree, right? But if it can be, but we can't let, you know, China go one-on-one with countries. There has to be a rules out there. So I think probably more than you ask for, Hongbin, but I think that's what we need to do. That's a great question.
Yeah. So another question is that, you know, China started a war against poverty in the past few years, right? Mm-hmm. So I think educating the poor people, especially in rural China, should be part of the war against poverty, right? Of course, this is not a short-run thing. You need to do them for many years, do it for many years. So a really question is that if you can talk to the Chinese government, by the way, so a question is that when do you plan to publish a Chinese version of the book? And if you can talk to the Chinese government, what kind of advice you can give them? What have they done, I mean, to deal with this problem in the past? You
know? Okay, those are two separate questions. the publishing thing is I have a contract in my hand. It's not actually in my hand. It's on my computer with the People's Press. This is the national press for the government to publish this book in Chinese. It was all ready to be published and the trade war started. And the People's Press decided that they couldn't publish books by Americans in this very sensitive time. So it's on their back burner, but this book is being translated into several languages. I can't translate it into Chinese because People's Press owns the Chinese translation rights. And so we'll see if they publish it. I hope they do. You know, it's been basically personally stamped by the top agricultural leader in China. He's the party secretary for the Agricultural Commission, Han Jun, who's a very good economist and who's somebody we've known for 30 years. Han Jun says this has to be published, and it's been vetted in the Planning Commission. So I hope it does come out, obviously, right? Number one. What was our other question, real quick?
What's the advice to the government
for poverty?
For education.
Oh, okay, for education. Yes, good. That's I'm much better at doing that. For education, it's the first thing is centralize all expenditures. Okay, the national government has to spend, you know, the entire, they have to cover all. Here's why. I did a very interesting survey. We have a Rural Education Action Project. We have collaborators in about 20 universities, different universities across China, all in Western Central provinces. They all have graduate students. Okay, they had about 20 graduate students on average. These 20 people, 20 graduate students, about 10 of them were over 25. So my sample is 200 people. I asked those 200 people, say, do you keep in touch with your three? I asked them three questions. Do you keep in touch with your classmates? Okay, guess what? 200 people have a WeChat group with their classmates, high school classmates, right? They've already graduated 10 years ago. I then ask them, how many of those high school classmates are rural? You know, and it's, you know, it was about 60% of them were rural. Okay, so it was about 12,000 of their classmates were rural. Then I asked them, okay, now, how many of those 12,000 rural classmates are in their home county? And guess what? 7%. 7%. So that's the problem, right? I'm a local government. I'm very tight with my money, right? I don't have a lot of fiscal revenues. Do I invest into rural education? Because if I educate these rural kids to high school, guess what? They leave and they never come back. So China benefits, but my rural community doesn't benefit. Yeah, right? I mean, this is a very common problem in the US too. And so I think that that's the number one thing they have to do. And then dramatically increase the amount of money that they spend. If you really, really want to know the solution to this problem, one of the fundamental solution problem, it's called get rid of the hukou system, right? Let the rural kids come into the cities and get educated. Yeah, that's a bigger issue.
Yeah, the hukou actually, that's answer to many of the questions about hukou. I think the final question, I think given the time, I'm going to ask a question from a student, probably from our Chinese economy class, actually. How would you advise American students who would like to engage with research in China, given the current tense political climate?
Well, first of all, you need to get a vaccine, right? And we need to get rid of COVID-19, and China needs to allow us to go to China, right? Exactly. You know, it's been, it'll be, I left China November 1st, 2019. So the day after tomorrow, it'll be 1 year since I've been to China, right? And I go 10 times a year, right? And so number one. But you know, today our group, because we work with Chinese collaborators, our groups are really busy. We have 8 projects in the field now. We actually are working with Stanford undergrads, FSI funded, thank you, in some cases, who are working with our collaborators. They help them, you know, get background material. They help them characterize the problem in the rest of the world. Then they write papers together, right? You know, 5 p.m. here is, you know, 9 a.m. in China, 8 a.m. in China. And, you know, they're writing papers and working together on these things. So there are, it's not as good as going to the field, but there still are research opportunities to get going. So.
Okay, given the time, so I think we need to close. There are a lot of questions unanswered. I think we are going to send this question to Scott. I think you, answer the questions in the future. Again, congrats to Scott for such a wonderful book. And I hope we can have more time to talk about this, maybe next time. Thank you all for joining us today. I hope to see you soon.
And thank you, everybody. Thank you, FSI, for hosting it and all the APARC, CDRL, and FSE, my homes at FSI, and CEPR. Thank you.